Now, coming to flexible contracts. So earlier we said there are things which can help you buying time. And then there are things which you don't know. So I said, all these are not risk by definition. These are uncertainties, things which you don't understand, things which you don't know about. And when you don't know things, best thing is learn. And for learning, you need time. That's where flexibility comes in. So a good example from what we already know are cost plus contracts. So hope all of you know cost plus contracts. In this case, you don't know what the complexities in building a project are. So you assure the contractor what will be the complexities, what will be the design changes that can happen on a frequent basis. You will reimburse him for that. That kind of trust, that kind of a relation is in cost plus contract. So when it's a complex project, where a lot of innovations, where a lot of uniqueness comes in, cost plus contracts both. Why? It's a flexibility. And why is a flexibility required? Because there's uncertainty in design and there's uncertainty in technology. Make sense? Flexibility can be a solution to manage complexity. It can be a solution to manage uncertainty. And another example is the flexible term concession in Chile. Earlier, we were mentioning that a road project is doing very well. By the end of 15th year, the road is overflowing. It's already in a block. So many cars on the road. And yet, the private company continues to collect the tolls. Why? The contract allows them to operate for 15 years. But already, they make 3-4 times of the money which they are entitled to make. A solution is called flexible term concessions. So the idea is that the concession period is not till 15 years. It is still at a time when you break even. What is good for the people? They don't have, if the traffic is good, the concession will, the tolling period will come maybe got over by maybe 10 years or 9 years. So good for them. For the remaining period, they don't have to pay the toll. Because the, and what is for the private company? What if the traffic is less? You don't make your money in 15 years. A flexible term concession allows you to operate the road for maybe like another 3 or 4 more years extra. Extend it automatically so that your risk of, you know, making a loss is lowered. So for the private concessionaire, his risk overall comes low. So it's basically like this. If it's a BOT, this is his likely return. High profits, high losses. But when it comes to an FTC, it becomes a steeper thing. You are not likely to make huge profits. You are at the same time similarly not likely to make huge losses. So this least percent value of revenue. So if you look at India, how highway contracts are allocated, we have something called a viability gap funding or negative grant. So based on the project model, the concessionaire comes to the government and says, okay, I need this much extra money. The terms will be defined. How the toll rates are calculated, the design specifications of the projects are often very clearly given. And the period for concession will be usually 20 years or 25 years. These all are given. So only variability is that in the revenue model, there will be a delta. The project cost versus revenue. Sometimes the project cost on your calculation will be higher than the expected revenue. So you ask the government, pay me X amount of money so that I will do this project for you. But for a different company, they do a different calculation. They have like this transformative mechanism by which they can bring in more revenue. So they are saying to the government, okay, you don't pay me X amount of money. I pay you Y amount of money. The second case is a negative grant. When the private company is making the government an offer for the money. First one is viability gap funding. So this viability gap, cost versus revenue, there's a gap. And government pays that gap to make the project viable, making it a viability gap funding. The projects are often negotiated on this amount. 5 companies coming, 3 demand for different amounts of viability gap funding. 2 come and offer the government a negative grant. And whoever offers the highest negative grant is the best suitable company for the government. So that's how this usually happens. However, in a least present value of revenue contract, you ask the government an NPV, the net present value of revenues they require from the project. The cost is something which you can manage. It's a construction risk, which is manageable by the contractor. So you ask the government, I need X amount as the NPV of the revenues. And the discount rate will be given by the government. Say 8%, 9%, 10%, whatever it be. The government gives it the discount rate. They do the cash flow model and say, so getting X amount of money in form of NPV, I am fine. I am done with the project. Concessionaire collects the toll and share the data regularly with the government. And the moment they break even, this target amount reaches, the project ends. As I said, the concession is not going to make huge profits or huge losses. And people are also in better off in this condition. Now, there's the question why it's not done. We will address that again later. Why these flexibilities are often not undertaken? Simple answer is that of these two graphs, BOT is a high risk, high return project. It's a high risk project, right? But if it's a flexible term concession, like in Chile, the risks are lower. Simplest observation is that most people in India or most people in this highway sector are risk-seeking people. They want to play with the risk. They don't want to reduce their risk. That can be a possible explanation why flexible term concessions did not pick up as much as BOTs. Now, the term real options. As I said, these are flexibilities. And finally, there are flexibilities which are mentioned in present in so many aspects. So often you build a house. This cost plus contracts. So cost plus contracts is a good flexibility, right? However, these things are often present in our day-to-day contracts of day-to-day life, but we often, you know, ignore them. The real option analysis mechanism, how we identify these flexibilities, value them so that they get more focused. Real options is a tool. It's like an approach by which you identify and create flexibility so that you create more robust, more strong contracts to tackle an uncertain environment. What is an option? An option is defined as a right, but not the obligation. So there's a person who is who has the option. So in a construction project or like in a PPP project, it's often the private sector developer. He has the option to do something, but he is not required to do that. So if he finds a situation required, you know, suitable, he uses that option. An example, look at a market. You are a farmer who produces, say, pineapples. You are a pineapple farmer. And you make an agreement with one of the shopkeepers that next Monday, I will sell you 100 kilos of pineapple for 50 rupees. Fine. So that contract is there. So you next Monday, you go to the market, walk around and find out the price for pineapple per kg is 60 rupees. So you don't go to that. You should go to even any other shop and sell it at 60 rupees. However, when you come back, you find the price at 40, you go to the shop, say, hey, I have this option. You offer, say that you buy pineapple from me at 50 rupees. That's a put option. You sell something, you have the option to sell something at a predetermined price. But if the price is actually better, there's no requirement of you to mandate it. A call option is the opposite of it. It's basically when the shopkeeper asks the farmer to sell the pineapple for him at 50 rupees. If the market price of pineapple is lesser, the shopkeeper is not required to buy it from the farmer. But if it's higher, he can demand the farmer, see, you asked me, you promised me to sell it at 50 rupees, so you have to sell it to me at 50 rupees. These are, you know, very day-to-day examples of options. All of us, you know, experience options in some form of the other in our day-to-day life. These kind of things, you know, all of us do that. So when it comes to power projects, these options are basically power purchase agreements. Rather than having a flexible demand for the power, the government makes the power sector developer say, I'll buy you this amount of power on an annual basis and this amount of money. So the revenue risk is capped. However, real options or options come with a price. So when the shopkeeper is saying that I will buy from you at 50 rupees, he's taking small amount of risk, right? For the risk or the decision he's making, he had to pay a small premium. That's what is an option premium. So if you're looking at stock market also, you can see the stock market is very dwindling. So you can make similar options, call options and put options. So you can pay an X amount of money to a third party and say, next week, I can buy Tata Motors share at 100 rupees. When you make such an offer, when the third party is offering to sell you Tata Motors share at 100 rupees next week, there's a covenant. And for that covenant, you pay a small premium price. And next week, if the cost of Tata Motors is lesser, you don't have to respect the covenant. But if it's higher, you can buy it. That's the idea of option and the option premium. So when you have an option, if you are the person who's having the option, you have to pay a premium for it. In a traditional revenue model, there's no probability coming in. Right? We did the traffic for the highway project. We don't do that. When you say traffic is going to grow by 5%, it's going to grow by 5%. There's no probability assigned. There's no risk assigned. However, in a real option analysis, you model the risk into the very basics of this revenue model and evaluate it with and without flexibilities. And that's how you find the value of these flexibilities and real options. Real options are nothing but flexibilities. And for having these flexibilities, often you have to make a small pay token amount so that, you know, your risk is lowered. As we categorized risk earlier, real options also can be categorized in multiple parameters. So a popular one is done by Gorgas. These are like 7 categories. So first one is option to defer. Again, the old project. You're building an highway and it's probable that airport can come in or not come in. So you're fine. I will not build the road now. I wait for like 6 months. See how the protest is going to turn out or how the airport is going to come up. So the protest is getting momentum. You understand, okay, fine. Very likely the airport is going to come and very likely the industries are going to go away. So fine. I'm not investing. Rather than making the investment right now, you have this option to delay it for like 6 or 7 months. Get a better understanding of how the situation is going to turn out. Second one is stage investment. The example which someone pointed out earlier. The highway, you develop a Kutcha Road into 2-lane highway. Then later you develop into 4-lane highway. Alternatively, you can develop into 4-lane highway right then. Problem is that you may not have a similar traffic, expected traffic. So you first make it into 2-lane highway. Then if the traffic is sufficient, you make it into 4-lane highway. So that's a stage development. Alter the operating scale. this can be something like, you know, your power generating company. So the capacity to produce maybe like 20 gigawatts. However, the government is asking you to buying from 50 gigawatt. You have the flexibility to reach your capacity if you're able to find the someone else who can buy the extra 5 gigawatt from you. So the ability to change the operating cycle, that's again a flexibility. When there's a flexibility, you get space to manage things. When you get the space, you know, you can use your skills to reduce the cost for you. Abandon. So the first airport case, you defer the option for 2 years. Then you find the industries are going away. You abandon the project. So in this abandoning case, often this abandonment option are present. Companies do take up projects and leave in between. However, if there's a clear mechanism present, you know, rules what to do when you abandon, the life is much easier for everyone involved. Then there's case of switching. You do a project, then you switch to a different mode. Something like, you know, you develop a project in BOT model. You realize that the traffic is less. You should switch it to an annuity model. For this, you have to pay a premium, right? That's a switching option. That's a growth option. Growth option is very similar to the stage investment. Interacting option is basically a combination of all these. That category is clear, I hope. Then we have a much simpler category, which has defined like bang and the filling. So this is options in the project. So when you have defined a project, these are projects which options which are part of the design. Projects are, you know, very complex things. So you make a change in the basic nature of the project. A good example is basically the expansion of a highway from 2-lane to 4-lane. You have to explore every nuance of it, from the technical design aspects, construction, materials, everything. So it's a, when you call an options in the projects, the flexibility is part of the design. It's not separate from the project. However, then there are things like called options on the projects. So when the options on the project, these flexibles are quite away from the project. An example is basically operating the road for like, you know, 10 years. Then you decide, okay, fine, I don't want to operate it anymore. I want the government to, you know, take it up from me. Or basically abandonment notion. Or you want to, you know, convert it from a BOT to a hybrid annuity. So the actual project, the road does not change. It's just basically how the contract works, which is like another layer, superficial layer. That's what changes. So options in the project is basically something inside. However, an option on the project is something more superficial. As you can guess, options in the projects are more difficult to create, model, and manage. And options on the projects are like cheaper and easier to manage. Going forward, we'll look at some of these examples and see, you know, how these categories work. These are some examples of real options from real life. So the first one is so as we know, mobile technology transformed every one of our lives in the past 20 years. However, before mobile technology came in, Motorola and Qualcomm independently started on a satellite telephone project. So they sent in many satellites, formed a network of satellites around the world, around the globe. So one was called GlobalStar, another one was called Iridium Space. So both these are satellite telephone technologies, and they invest huge amount of money in creating this network of satellites. The problem was that by the time the satellite network was set up, mobile technology came in, which is much more cheaper technology, and these people lost like a lot of money. I mean, Motorola is a major telephone manufacturer. I think Motorola invented mobile phones, in fact. But what happened? Motorola is somewhere in the picture. The reason was this huge investment in a wrong technology. Imagine if they were doing this in a stage investment stage, had a stage investment option. We have a stage investment or a growth option. So rather than sending in all the satellites in one go, they select 3 or 4 satellites, maybe for their catering to one particular region. And understand how people are, you know, responding to a satellite telephone technology. And based on that, you expand. In that case, see, from the history, we know it's going to fail. But they wouldn't have lost that much amount if they had a stage investment option. And that's a case when people fail to use real option. It's a bad case of real option. And other side, we have something called Ponte de April. It's very similar to the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco. But the difference is that this is in Lisbon, Portugal. This project was built in 1966. When they were building 1966, they actually created 2 decks, one on top and one on the bottom. When they're creating these 2 decks, it's definitely cheaper to create. There was no demand for 2 decks, okay? The demand was only for 1 deck. But they ensured that the structure, the pillions are strong enough to create the second deck so that or they create enough space under the main deck so that the second deck can be installed. Idea was, if a traffic picks up, we can make it into a double-decker bridge. They invested an extra cost in creating that, right? For a stronger pillions, stronger cables, more space between the under the deck, so that another deck can be put in. So that extra investment is basically the option premium. In the first case, when they lost all the, Motorola lost all the satellites together, they had the economies of scale. It's cheaper to launch 100 satellites at one go rather than, you know, one satellite at 100 times. So if they had to launch it on a staged manner, they would have to incur a higher expense. But that higher expense, or by losing the economies of scale, was the option premium, which they did not choose. But in Lisbon, they choose their option premium. They spent their option premium and bought that option. What happened? 1998, they expanded the bridge, put on a railway network below the deck. Both the railway as well as the road is having a lot of traffic. They did not put the railway right away. They created the option to add a railway or another road by making a stronger bridge. And later, when the opportunity came in, they exercised it. So that's a good case, or a case where they successfully used the rail option.